So the public health system in the DRC and the Democratic Republic of Congo is straining, first under measles and cholera, then Ebola, and now coronavirus. UNICEF says coronavirus poses the latest threat to a really battered health system in the DRC. And if you look at these pictures and these scenes, you can see how easily the virus could spread along the busy streets of a town like, city like Goma, for example. Take a listen to freelance filmmaker Thomas Nybo.
We just rolled into one of the most popular markets in Goma, and as you can see, it's business as usual. No social distancing.
So that was Thomas on the streets of Goma, and he joined us now live from the DRC. Thomas, good to see you. In many ways, as people complain about having to be stuck at home in a never-ending sort of schedule, it's a luxury. Social distance is a luxury, because in many places of the world, it is just not possible, as you just pointed out there.
That's exactly right, Robyn. What you have to remember is 3 out of 4 people in DR Congo live on less than $2 a day, which is the definition of extreme poverty. So what you're seeing across Africa when you're having these lockdowns is people are forced to make a very difficult decision if they don't have any food on hand. They either starve or riot. Even in Kinshasa, there was a 4-day lockdown that was supposed to be in place, but the threat of looting made the government back off. And here in Goma, it's especially dangerous. As you saw from my video, the streets are full of people. Now, the restaurants are closed, most of the flights are suspended, the borders are shut down, but it's business as usual in many ways. And if you have a family of 5 or 6 people, and a mother, for instance, who needs to feed those 5 or 6 children, staying at home does not seem to be an option for her.
No, it's not. And again, that's why I said it is a luxury being able to social distance or order on Amazon. Give us also an understanding. This is a highly vulnerable population already. This latest virus is compounded on top of other health emergencies. How does that play into it?
If you go back to the Ebola outbreak, what's happened here in the Congo, especially in the east, it's a very delicate, dangerous situation because you have instability. You have brutal militia attacks which have displaced more than 1 million people. Everyone talks about Ebola. They talk about COVID-19. But what you have to remember is this country is in the middle of the world's worst measles outbreak. 5,300 children under the age of 5 have died in the past year. So while COVID-19 presents a problem, you have to look at the basic health structure. Many of the hospitals lack basic equipment. They lack toilets. They lack clean water. So it is perhaps the most vulnerable population in Africa.
As you know, I used to be CNN's Africa correspondent, and anybody who's reported from the continent in the last few decades knows that instability in the Congo has a ripple effect across the continent. What does it mean? How vulnerable is it? How important is it that the Congo is in the center there of Africa, and this is such a ticking time bomb in many ways?
It sets a dangerous precedent because while it's a very poor country, it's minerally rich. So there's a lot of international business. A lot of people look to DR Congo for guidance. And in these communities, it's very fragile, as we saw with Ebola, where in a moment, the local populations can blame outsiders for spreading the disease. I'm on the streets with UNICEF doing work every day, and increasingly, 6, 7, 8 people a day are accusing me of spreading coronavirus. And if you look in these communities, there's a lot of fear. There's a lot of explanations that, oh, this is the coming apocalypse. So it's very dangerous and, as you mentioned, very precedent-setting, perhaps.
Yeah, and again, that warning that leaders have to have very clear messaging in times like this. Don't confuse the populations. Thomas, appreciate it. Freelance filmmaker there on the ground. I know you're doing, as you said, other work as well for UNICEF. Thank you very much for bringing us this story.
Thank you, Robyn.